The audacious assault on Pearl Harbor was a thunderbolt that shattered America's pride, wrenching its isolationist stance in the theater of war. The sudden, lethal, and massively destructive attack aimed to eradicate the US's Pacific Armada in a single surge of violence. But Japanese ambition was not confined to this solitary act of defiance. As the infamous Pearl Harbor assault was leaving its brutal imprint, the Imperial Japanese forces ignited a maelstrom of destruction across the Pacific, ambushing the unsuspecting American troops stationed in the Philippines and Guam, and the susceptible British forces in Malaya. Sweeping through Thailand to Hong Kong, and all the way to Hawaii, the Japanese unleashed their synchronized orchestra of ruin in a way that would take the Allies by storm. On the night of December 8, 1941, on the tiny coral atoll of Wake Island, a US Army radio operator's blood ran cold as he received a chilling message. Quote, SOS, SOS, Japs attacking Oahu. This is the real thing, no mistake. Major James Devereaux, engulfed in grim certainty, knew that Wake would be next and commanded his men to fortify their defenses. Pilots sprinted across the tarmac, clambering into their Wildcats. Their engines roared to life, and within moments they pierced the skies, their eyes scanning the horizon in a desperate search for the impending Japanese onslaught. Across the island, servicemen dug deep, their hearts heavy with dread as they braced for the impending clash. Soon, their worst nightmares took form. Japanese warplanes and warships in vastly superior numbers emerged on the horizon. Outnumbered, outgunned, and caught unaware, the Americans would still find a way to deliver a comeback that would etch an unforgettable lesson into the heart of the Japanese assault force. A lonely speck of land floats like a lighthouse amid the vast sapphire expanse of the Pacific. Some 2,000 miles west of Hawaii and halfway to Japan's shores, this isolated atoll, an ensemble of coral islets christened Wilkes, Peel, and Wake, had once captured the keen eyes of 19th century American naval strategists. Shrouded within the unending azure, Wake Island was deemed the perfect bastion for a forward defense in a theoretical war against an Asian power, most likely Japan, claiming the island would be a strategic advantage for any side of the possible conflict. Still, the United States had a massive head start when it claimed the island in 1899 to project its naval power toward Asia. The official story was that the US claimed the landmass under the Guano Islands Act. This act, passed in 1856, allowed US citizens to claim islands containing guano deposits or bird droppings used as fertilizer. The island did not have any significant amounts of fertilizer. Still, the US claimed dominion over the atoll anyways, as it was a strategically ideal position to guard their recently annexed territory of Hawaii, as well as the Philippines, and Guam, which it had obtained after victory in the Spanish-American War in 1898. Still, the island's remote location made it challenging to develop, and it stayed barren for decades. In his visionary 1921 work, Sea Power in the Pacific, a study of the American-Japanese naval problem, Hector C. Bywater recognized the strategic value of Wake Island, envisioning it as a fortified refueling station for US Navy vessels, potentially locking horns with Japan in future maritime confrontations. Japan's expansionist and imperialistic ambitions were clear from that early period, as was its dissatisfaction with what it had gained from fighting on the side of the Allies in World War I. Bywater knew a clash in the Pacific against Japan was not only likely but inevitable if both nations continued their path. Despite its potential in a war of such nature, Wake Island lay forgotten and untouched until the dawn of 1941. Then, under the relentless work of an alliance of civilian firms, the atoll began a drastic transformation that aimed to turn it into a military fortress in the middle of the sea. The droning hum of machinery reverberated across the coral, and the acrid tang of molten metal permeated the salty air as buildings sprung up from the sand, transforming the barren island into a formidable military stronghold. As Europe was swallowed in a war like the world had never seen before, US analysts knew it was only a matter of time before a clash against Japan materialized in the Pacific. Wake Island would now serve the purpose for which it had been claimed many years ago. From the eastern horizon, Japan loomed ever closer. When the Empire of the Rising Sun decided to wake the sleeping giant by attacking Pearl Harbor, It also decided to take Wake Island as a forward base of operations. Its adjacency to the Japanese-occupied Marshall Islands made the atoll an attractive bounty. This minuscule sliver of land, a mere 2.85 square miles in area, was an enticing stepping stone that edged the empire tantalizingly closer to American shores. The day Japan unleashed its fury over the Pacific, it caught Wake Island utterly unprepared for the assault and firepower it was about to deliver. The island was still undergoing its transformation and did not have the manpower, defensive positions, or armaments necessary to repel a large Japanese military force. The defense of this remote outpost rested on the shoulders of a distressingly small band of committed fighters who, before hearing the distressing reports of the attack on Pearl Harbor, expected anything but combat in their remote and peaceful little island in the Pacific. A contingent of 449 U.S. Marines, a sprinkling of Navy personnel, a few Army radio operators, and 1,100 civilian workers were all that stood between the atoll and the impending tsunami of Japanese aggression. According to American strategists, the garrison was short nearly 2,100 men from what was needed to mount an adequate defense for what the Japanese had in store for them. The island's defensive arsenal was worryingly sparse. 6 5-inch coastal artillery guns, 12 3-inch anti-aircraft guns, a dozen F-4F Wildcat fighters, and a smattering of machine guns and small arms fortified the atoll's resistance. The garrison was further bolstered by 45 Guamanian men, who were part of Pan American Airways' Trans-Pacific Clipper Service. On December 7th, as plumes of smoke spiraled from the wreckage of Pearl Harbor, the Guardians of Wake Island received the message they dreaded the most. They were at war and would be next. The horizon bled an ominous darkness, brimming with the imminent menace of war. The island awaited its fate. It was synchronized destruction. The Pearl Harbor attack occurred on the morning of December 7th, 1941, Hawaii time. Because Wake Island is across the international dateline from Hawaii, it was December 8th on Wake at the time of the attack. As such, both onslaughts happened only a few hours apart, giving the terrified soldiers guarding the Wake Atoll only precious minutes to brace for what was coming. Commander Winfield Scott Cunningham, the naval officer in command of Wake Island, received a message from Pearl Harbor warning of the attack. The announcement was brief but chilling. Quote, Pearl Harbor attacked. Implement war plan. The Marines, civilian contractors, and other Wake Island military personnel immediately began deploying defensive measures. They had already been on a wartime footing due to increasing tensions between Japan and the United States. Still, many U.S. servicemen did not believe Japan would dare attack the U.S. Navy. The garrison knew they would most likely be the target for Japanese forces due to Wake Island's strategic location, but they did not know exactly when an attack would come. They had their answer some hours later, when the Japanese launched air attacks against the island, targeting the airfield and other installations. Wake Island was jolted by the roar of Japanese bombers overhead. The U.S. garrison scrambled as bombs rained down, turning the once tranquil island into a fiery inferno. Aircraft were destroyed and vital installations were damaged. Of the 12 Wildcats stationed at the island, 8 were obliterated and the Nisqually scow ship was sunk by Japanese fire. Men fought valiantly to repel the air raid, their anti-aircraft guns spewing fire into the sky, but the attacks continued to come in waves. One American pilot, Captain Henry T. Elrod, stood out for his exceptional skills and courage. He took to the sky, outnumbered by enemy planes 5-1, and still, he managed to go on the offensive and take out 2 of the 22 attacking Japanese bombers. 2 more air raids followed. The main camp was targeted on December 9th, ravaging the civilian hospital and the Pan Am air compound. The next day, Japanese bombers focused on outlying Wilkes Island. Following the raid on December 9th, the 4 anti-aircraft guns were relocated in case the Japanese had photographed the positions. Wooden replicas were erected in their place. The scheme paid off, and the Japanese bombers attacked the decoy positions, leaving the defending anti-aircraft gun ready to keep the enemy at bay. But not everything was good news. A lucky strike on a civilian dynamite depot set off a chain reaction that destroyed the munitions for the guns on Wilkes, leaving that section of the atoll vulnerable. In the wake of the furious aerial assaults on the 8th, 9th, and 10th, The island's defenders found themselves exhausted and drained, having no respite amid the blistering attacks. The air was thick with the acrid scent of burnt metal and fuel as the men surveyed the smouldering wreckage left by the Japanese bombers. Commander Winfield Cunningham and Major James Devereaux, the two leaders of this threatened outpost, wasted no time in rallying their men and making sure they understood that the aerial attacks were probably the prelude to a major landing operation. The worst was yet to come. The island, scarred but unbroken, bustled with activity as Marines and civilians worked shoulder to shoulder to patch the few remaining wildcats, lay down sandbags, turning every building into a fortress. Anti-aircraft guns were cleaned and loaded, their barrels glinting under the tropical sun. On the morning of December 11th, as the waves crashed against the shore, the men of Wake Island stood ready, but they did not suspect the scale of what was coming. In the pre-dawn darkness of December 11th, 1941, the indomitable waves of the Pacific lapped against the hulls of a massive Japanese naval flotilla. The salty sea air was thick with anticipation as Rear Admiral Sadamichi Kajioka, a stern figure with a sharp gaze, peered out from the bridge of Yubari, the flagship light cruiser leading the fleet. With its destroyers Kisaragi, Mutsuki, Hayate, Oite, Asanagi and Yayoi, and the light cruisers Tenryu and Tatsuta, the armada sliced through the waters towards Wake Island. Below decks, nearly 450 Special Naval Landing Force troops, Japan's elite warriors, were clad in battle gear. On converted destroyers, patrol boats 32 and 33, they tightened their grip on their rifles, dreams of conquest and honor in their eyes. Admiral Kajioka's plan is simple but lethal. The devastating air raids of the previous days should have left the island weak and its defenders injured and disorganized. His fleet would weaken the defenses even more by unleashing a ruthless naval bombardment. The naval barrage would obliterate all remaining defenses, leaving the island free for his troopers to disembark and claim. The Americans, he believed, would be but a minor obstacle easily swept aside by the might of the Japanese Empire. As dawn broke, the island's silhouette emerged. The fleet's big guns thundered, shaking the waters around the atoll, but as the artillery echoes rolled across the waves, something unexpected happened. Far from the easy prey they were expected to be, the Americans fought like cornered tigers. Their coastal artillery and a small squadron of wildcat fighters tore into the Japanese fleet. In a stroke of tactical genius, Devereaux ordered the gunners to hold their fire until the Japanese ships moved closer to the coastal defenses. When the fire resumed, the Japanese were met with a hailstorm of metal and fire. As the shells from the Americans' 6.5-inch coast defense guns screamed through the air, one found its mark. Fired 4,000 yards away, a direct hit from Battery L on Hayate's magazine turned the destroyer into an inferno. Hayate was torn apart with a thunderous croak, leaving all the Japanese sailors witnessing the event dumbfounded and shocked. The sea around the sinking ship was a maelstrom of fire and smoke. The waves swallowed the men who had manned her decks, with only one sailor surviving the attack. Hayate became the first Japanese warship to be sunk during the Pacific War. It immediately taught Kajioka a grueling lesson. It did not pay to underestimate the Americans. But the Hayate was not the only target of American sights. Battery A claimed to have hit Yubari on several occasions. Captain Henry T. Elrod also continued his heroic streak aboard his Wildcat, successfully sinking the destroyer Kisaragi by dropping a bomb on her stern where depth charges were stored. Two Japanese destroyers were lost, with a recorded 407 casualties during the landing attempt. Admiral Kajioka's stern face turned grim as the appalling debacle unraveled. His underestimation of the enemy was a sword that cut deep. Around him, the sea was ablaze, and the air was thick with the screams of man and metal. Swallowing his pride, Kajioka gave the order to retreat. The Japanese, approaching Wake Island as an unstoppable force, withdrew into the horizon. Hurt and defeated, the elite soldiers that survived were overtaken by a sorrowful silence. On Wake Island, the Americans were ecstatic. They had just executed one of the most incredible defensive operations in modern history, and the story became a rallying cry for all US forces in the Pacific in the wake of the horrendous attack on Pearl Harbor. Spirits were so high that Commander Cunningham was reported to have remarked, quote, "Send us more Japs," when asked what he needed to bolster the island's defenses. The defenders of Wake Island had become symbols of American determination and courage, and the US military brass was not keen on leaving them stranded on the island until a more significant Japanese force finally defeated them. But the situation in the Pacific Theater was not favorable for the Americans. With reports of continuous Japanese activity close to Wake Island and the remainder of the US Pacific Fleet thinly spread across the ocean, relieving the defenders of the atoll became less likely by the minute. Nevertheless, Admiral Fletcher's Task Force 14, known as TF-14, was fraught with a pivotal mission, the daunting rescue and relief of Wake Island. Meanwhile, Admiral Brown's Task Force 11, TF-11, readied themselves for a daring diversionary assault on the distant Jaluit Island, nestled in the Marshall Islands. The formidable Third Task Force, headed by Vice Admiral Halsey and firmly centered on USS Enterprise, was tasked with reinforcing the other two forces as the Japanese 2nd Carrier Division remained in the area of operations, presenting a significant risk. TF-14 had everything it needed to launch a rescue operation and relieve the fighter of Wake Island. It consisted of the fleet carrier Saratoga, flanked by the oiler Neches, the seaplane tender Tangier, and three cruisers: Astoria, Minneapolis, and San Francisco. Their vanguard was a fleet of 8 destroyers. This convoy was an ecosystem of war, housing munitions, replacement parts, servicemen, and advanced radar systems, everything it would take to stave off the imposing adversary. As the Armada dashed across the water, relief for the Wake defenders seemed closer than ever. However, as the clock struck 9 p.m. on December 22nd, an urgent transmission cut through the crackling silence of the war room. It revealed the presence of 2 Imperial Japanese Navy carriers and 2 fast battleships, ominously lurking near Wake Island. The intelligence was faulty, as the battleships were actually cruisers, but the damage was done. Vice Admiral William S. Pye, the acting commander-in-chief of the U.S. Pacific Fleet, made a hard decision. With a sigh, he ordered the TF-14 to make a U-turn, withdrawing them back to Pearl Harbor. The defenders of Wake Island were on their own. No help was coming. There would be no supplies and no reinforcements. The echoes of the defiant stand by the garrison had rippled through the ranks of the Japanese Navy, compelling them to muster a mighty array of warships. Their response was swift and decisive. The 2nd Carrier Division saw you and hear you, accompanied by the 8th Cruiser Division and 17th Destroyer Division, fresh from their offensive at Pearl Harbor, were dispatched with ruthless intent. Accompanying them was the 6th Cruiser Division, Destroyer Oboro, Seaplane Tender Kiyokawa Maru, and Mine Layer Tenyo Maru, each bearing the battle scars from their campaign in Guam. Reinforcements from the 29th Destroyer Division, veterans of the Gilbert Islands invasion, augmented the formidable assault force. Thus, the 2nd Japanese invasion was set into motion on December 23rd, bolstered by 1,500 seasoned Japanese Marines. Back on the island, the same force of fewer than 400 servicemen waited anxiously as they wondered if another Japanese invasion would strike before reinforcements arrived. They were reaching the limits of their endurance and resolve after enduring 2 weeks of Japanese aerial and naval bombardments. As the clock struck 2:35 a.m., the silence was shattered by a barrage of artillery fire, paving the way for the Japanese to storm different strategic points on the atoll. Undeterred, Lieutenant Robert Hanna led a staunch resistance with a formidable 3-inch gun, obliterating the former destroyer's patrol boat No. 32 and patrol boat No. 33. Simultaneously, a company of Japanese Special Naval Landing Forces launched an attack on Wilkes Island, making headway until they were met with fierce counterattack led by Captain Platt. The fierce American resistance initially inflicted heavy casualties on the Japanese, forcing them to retreat to their landing area. Captain Elrod also played a crucial role in ground combat during the Japanese landing on December 23rd. After all the aircraft were disabled, he organized the remaining ground troops and held off the Japanese as long as possible. Using a machine gun at the extreme south of the island, he was able to repel numerous waves of Japanese soldiers. Eventually, Captain Elrod lost his life while protecting his men and trying to repel a final Japanese push. His last words to the remaining defenders over the radio were, quote, "The enemy is on the island. They drove through." Following a grueling bout of fighting, the remaining Marines fell back to a last line northeast of the airfield, where they were overrun by an infiltrating force of 100 Japanese commandos that took them by surprise, eroding their outer defenses. This assault marked the end of the island's resistance, resulting in the surrender of the remaining garrison. In the wake of the brutal 15-day siege, the US forces suffered considerable losses of 49 Marines, 2 missing, and 49 wounded. The assault also claimed the lives of 3 US Navy personnel and over 70 US civilians. In total, 433 US personnel were captured, the majority being civilian contractors from the Morrison Knudsen Company. In their relentless pursuit of the island, the Japanese forces suffered 144 casualties, with an additional 4 aboard ships. They also suffered losses in the air, with at least 28 land-based and carrier aircraft either shot down or damaged by anti-aircraft fire and the heroic efforts of the 4 Wildcats that had guarded Wake's skies against every odd. Captain Henry T. Elrod's incredible exploits and inspiring leadership led him to be posthumously awarded the Medal of Honor for his indomitable spirit and courage. His gallant actions on the island, from shooting down 2 Japanese G3M Nels and sinking the Japanese destroyer Kisaragi to leading ground troops in the absence of operational US aircraft, made him a beacon of hope amidst the dire circumstances. In honor of those who had defended the island, a special military decoration, the Wake Island Device, was created and affixed to either the Navy Expeditionary Medal or the Marine Corps Expeditionary Medal. Despite most of the defenders falling in battle or being captured, one individual managed to escape, Lieutenant Colonel Walter Baylor. He made a daring escape from Wake Island aboard a US Navy PBY Catalina on December 20th. As a radio technician, his skills were invaluable elsewhere, warranting his extraction in the only available aircraft. Baylor, armed with an accurate account of the events on Wake Island, became a crucial messenger to the American people, providing them with first-hand accounts, photographs, and maps of the island. His narratives were published nationwide, but the American public was left to mourn for the heroes of Wake Island and the circumstances that led to them being abandoned to face their grim fate. As the tension of imminent invasion loomed, the Japanese reinforced Wake Island's defenses. The American captives found themselves under harsh orders, constructing a series of bunkers and fortifications that marred the island's serene landscapes. 4 intimidating 8-inch naval guns were transported to the island. The US Navy, keen on crippling the enemy's supplies, set up a submarine blockade, effectively cutting off Wake Island. The siege led the Japanese garrison to desperation and starvation, cast a grim shadow over the island, forcing them to hunt the Wake Island rail, an endemic bird, into extinction. On February 24, 1942, the tranquility of the island was shattered once more as aircraft from the carrier Enterprise descended upon the Japanese garrison. These attacks would continue until the end of the war. In a significant assault on July 24, 1943, B-24 Liberators, led by Lieutenant Jesse Stay of the 42nd Squadron, struck a decisive blow to the Japanese garrison. This raid, originating from Midway Island, earned distinguished flying crosses to at least 2 men for their commendable bravery. Among the aerial warriors who battled over Wake's skies was a figure who would later shape American history, the future President George H.W. Bush. His first combat sortie as a naval aviator unfolded over the beleaguered Wake Island. Still, for the prisoners of war of Wake Island, their plight would be long and harrowing. They would have to endure some of the most horrific treatment known to man for years until the island was finally liberated. On October 5th, 1943, the American naval aircraft from the Lexington broke the silence, swooping down on Wake Island and raining fire over the camps. The operation left the starving Japanese seething, and this led to a grim turn of events 2 days later, when an American civilian worker caught in the act of thievery met a gruesome end, ordered by Japanese naval captain Shigematsu Sakebara. However, the captain's dread of an impending invasion led to a far more harrowing massacre. 97 additional captives, kept initially for forced labor, were marched to the northern end of the island. Blindfolded, they met their tragic end under a relentless hail of machine gun fire. During this chilling execution, a lone prisoner managed to escape running into the jungle as bullets grazed his skin. He later returned to the scene under cover of night, and left an eerie testament to the carnage, inscribing 98 USPW May 10th, 43 on a large coral rock marking the hastily buried mass grave. The defiant man could not stay hidden for long and was eventually recaptured. Sakibara himself delivered the final punishment with a katana. The carved rock endures to this day as a haunting landmark on Wake Island. Finally, on September 4th, 1945, the surviving Japanese garrison surrendered to a detachment of United States Marines under the command of Brigadier General Lawson H.M. Sanderson. The official ceremony took place aboard the destroyer escort levy. Before this, the garrison had hastily exhumed the mass grave and moved the remains to the U.S. cemetery established on Peacock Point, erecting wooden crosses in anticipation of the arrival of U.S. forces in a desperate attempt to hide their horrific crimes. The Japanese, during interrogations, spun a tale of an American bombing raid, holding the blame for the 98 American prisoners being lost. However, under the weight of guilt and dishonor, several Japanese officers took their own lives. Their final written confessions implicated Sakibara in the horrifying massacre. A subsequent trial unveiled a litany of war crimes. On June 19, 1947, Sakibara paid the ultimate price for his crimes. His second in command, Lieutenant Commander Tachibana, saw his sentence commuted to life in prison. The remains of the innocent civilians who perished in this tragic episode were exhumed solemnly and reinterred in Section G of the National Memorial Cemetery of the Pacific, known colloquially as the Punch Bowl Crater in Honolulu. This act of remembrance drew a permanent, mournful mark on the chronicles of the island's history. The Battle of Wake Island is etched in the annals of history as a two-sided coin. On one face, it was a brilliant triumph against overwhelming odds, standing as a testament to defiance, courage, and the unyielding American spirit. But on the other, it was a harrowing defeat. The failure to rescue the brave American fighters who were left stranded, facing an unspeakable fate, cast a sad shadow on this tale of bravery. The echoes of their sacrifice continue to resonate, a reminder of the cost of war.